So Monday morning, and another week has passed, and in the last episode I basically tried to confine the file system analyzer, the known file system analyzer, and that episode basically was pretty chaotic because some other unrelated issues arise, which basically made me lose my concentration, and so it was a bit messy episode, but eventually the file system analyzer should have been confined. We are going to verify that today, and then see if we can confine another component of the default GNOME environment. So the idea was for the file system analyzer that the user could use it to basically analyze the home directory, but not the other the system space, so to speak. Although there are some currently some exceptions, so it does actually show some information, just not probably just not accurate, and not all. So let's just have a look at that. And by the way, we also confined the GNOME System Monitor a few chapters previously, and we did the GNOME Shell, and inside the GNOME Shell we did the mail program, the mail user agent, and we did some top PS stuff. So without further ado, let's just log in and see if we are able to do that without issues. So let's go to the first screen and see if we can just log in. This is a clean boot. The directory has been cleared of my login user, and so this should give us a pretty clean view. See if it's something messes up, then we know. But it seems to work fine. So let's just verify that we are in enforcing, and well, this is the host, so it's not related, but just for shits and giggles, this is it enforcing, and get enforced. This is the actual guest. It's also enforcing. Let's just list the user, see what's going on. Grab 10, 12. This is actually the user session, and seems all everything is confined properly. And let's have a look at ls all z home my login user. And seems all fine. Oh yeah, we also basically created a private type for bash config file, so that we can basically try and protect bash from the confined user application. So now if you look at the user home directory, it's pretty much confined. The only thing that is not confined currently is the generic xdg home directory, so basically the desktop directory, the documents, downloads, music, pictures, public, templates and videos, and that's because this is basically shared user content. It's user content that is shared, should be shared between the various confined user applications. So it should be generic, and the same goes for any files created by the user in its user directory. So if the user, for example, touches a file in his user directory, then that should be user home T as well, because we expect that to be generic user home content, unless it's a known file. So for example, if the cache directory wouldn't exist and the user would create the cache directory, then as a Linux should basically be instructed to create that cache directory with the cache home type, and we haven't done that yet, but that's basically one of the cleanup things that we need to do eventually. Then when we're all done, make sure that if the user creates any of the content that has a private type, that the user also creates that with a private type. But that's still to be done because currently the user doesn't even have access to all of its content, and I'm even not sure if I should allow the user access to various content inside the config cache local share directories. Probably should, but that's just something we need to think about more closely, whether we want that or whether we want to make that tunable, conditional. So anyways, this all looks fine, it's all good. And for example, lsalz run user, run user 1012, and this as well, it looks fine. Like dconf is confined, gvfs is confined, or at least confined, restricted, protected with a private type. The keyring is protected with a private type. Now this krb, this kerberos dir, is created by XDM. We can see that because the identity identifier is system use, so we know that, and the user is my login user, so we basically know that, at least I know that I can identify that this directory was created by probably the GNOME session worker that was executed by in the XDM domain as the user. It's a bit messy how that works, but basically XDM runs the GNOME session worker as the normal user, but at that point it wasn't transitioned yet to the user domain, or to a user domain, so it was basically still running as XDM from as a Linux perspective. But from a traditional Linux security perspective, it was already running as my login user. So the directory was basically created, and this is a rule that's from Fedora. Fedora probably has a rule where XDM can create this directory with a user temp type. So we didn't want to mess with that stuff. We basically said, okay, this is an add-on module. We're not going to break anything. Any design decisions made by Fedora's, because we want this to integrate well. So, but basically if you look in there, then there is some add-on stuff that we did, because I basically so there's this file created in there. I'm not sure exactly if I forgot who creates it, but it's in the policy. If you want to find it, just grab for primary tempty and you'll see what creates it. But this file is protected. And this file is actually just created by one of the user application domains, or maybe even the user domain itself, not sure. You should look it, you can look it up. And this is also created, this is even created by XDM or by X server as a root. So this is basically not even, this is something that X server probably does, or XDM does to all user runtime directories. So it's also with a generic tempty type, but doesn't really matter because it basically points, it's a symlink, it points to temp, and we don't have access to temp in the first place, so it doesn't really matter if you basically look at it from my perspective, where I just basically want to protect or confine the user space. So I'm not protecting the user space from the system space, but I'm protecting the user space from the user's perspective. So with that said, and then you have temp, but there's no business in temp. I can basically ls all it, but users don't have access to either run use the runtime dirs or the temp dirs, but Pulse Audio does have access to temp for creating its ESD directory here, and the pools directory here, which are both protected, but the user itself can't access it. Only pools audio can access it on behalf of the user. So yeah, that's done. So we managed to log in properly right now. Let's see if we have AVC denials. TS, and let's make that 10 o'clock. Takes a long time because I have a lot of added rules. So let's make it 9:45. I just want to make sure that we logged in without any ABC denials added to allow. When I have this clean slate, and this is basically confirming it, because this is named conf, this is actually my DNSSEC related name server configuration, trying to basically add a file to the DNS configuration directory, which it shouldn't do because that should be read only. It should basically create that there in a stateful directory, for example varlib, and then it's the name of the daemon or something like that. But anyways, it confirms, because this happens before the user logs in, that with regard to the user logging in, there's no ABC denial, so that's clean. So now let's just try it where we stopped in the previous example, that file system, that disk user analyzer. So let's just run it. Well, just running it doesn't actually give us any ABC denials. So basically, when you look here, we can actually see the disk usage. It's 4.6 gigabytes out of 247 gigabytes. Now this is not accurate as far as I'm concerned. Let's just have a look at that from another. So DFH, so if you look at it, you have a size of 231 gigs and use 4.4 gigs, so it kind of is accurate, kind of, but it's not the full story. So it's working, it's trying to basically get us the usage diagram, but it can't find it because it's denied access there. But it finds some stuff, so it could not scan folder slash or some of its folders it contains, permission denied. But we didn't seem to have any AFC denial, so that's fine. This is exactly what I wanted. Let's see if it's actually clean. And it's still clean, so fine. That's basically the last rule that we added in the previous episode. I basically added a rule that says don't audit open get attribute, probably for file socks files, character files, any files that are on the file system, and then also don't audit, basically silently deny the disk user analyzer trying to search any directory. And that basically just silently denies everything except the stuff that it's currently allowed to do. And then basically here you can see a bunch of stuff in red that it can't access, and then there's the orange stuff that has stuff that it that basically tells us that okay, it can't access some of it, probably. That's what I expect. So I'll close this. So it's just not accurate. This shouldn't be accurate as far as I'm concerned. So let's go back. So this is with regard to the user home directory. Now this is accurate, and this is what the user should be able to see. So this is and this works, seems to work. And then you can basically, well, you can't actually get into these directories, as you can see. So that's nice. It can actually, well, it seems at least, not exactly sure, but this is probably a directory, but for some reason and it's also empty. So tracker is same thing. Evolution. You see, this basically this program needs to be able to access every user home content, because it needs to basically see how, if it's filled and with what it's filled. So it basically has full access to user home content. The user itself doesn't, but this program does have it, and some of these directories are empty, and that's why it's basically not showing you plus sign. So far so good, I guess. And then you can basically use this stuff, and this probably will at some point throw an AVC denial. So let's just still not throwing AVC denial, but here you have basically the root file system, and let's just tell it to scan serve, and permission is denied, but no AVC denials are thrown, so that's good. That's exactly what I wanted, and it's red, so it means that it can't actually do that. Let's see, recently used. So here here we have an AVC denial. So that's the first for today. I'll dismiss that and have a look at it with the out search command. So this is nice, or nice, this is expected. So this is something that we should just add. So we're going to nano my login user, type of forcement, and then go to the baobab section, and then GTK. Do we have any rules pertaining to GTK home T here? Not that I can see, but the issue is, and this is probably also common to all user applications, yeah, this is actually we already have a section here, remove name, and with regard to file set attribute, so this is something that was already in there, so we just basically needed to extend that. It didn't have all the permissions needed. This is basically the GTK bookmarks file for GTK 3.0. we have the GTK dash bookmarks in the user home directory, the file, and we have the, that's a 2.0 version, GTK 2.0 version, and the GTK 3.0 version is basically in the config, the period config dir, and then GTK /dash 3.0, and then there's a bookmarks file in there. So that's basically the 3.0 version of the basically a period GTK dash bookmarks in the user home directory. So that's basically something we should have, we should allow it. But for some reason, well, not for some reason, that's basically we overlooked that, and that that happens. Oops, user share as a Linux dval make file, and then just build that, make a no such file, no user share as a Linux dval. Oh, we have a typo. And then basically SE module my login user pp, and that's an I for insert or install. Okay, so we basically did catch a bug still, and that's why I always say you need to basically test thoroughly your policy, because there's always something that you have overlooked. That one is overlooked, unless you basically tested it for a month, then you have it all. And then you have this search, so I can basically search, try to search, let's just search for config, and there's already an AVC denial. Let's have a look at what else we have for everything else. This is allowed, but here we have a IBIS issue. Oops. So that's more. Do we have any IBIS related stuff? I don't think we do. We have, so we'll just add that in there. And do we have any other IBIS config home T so that we can basically borrow, because this is common stuff. All of these programs need localization access. So let's just find something related. So here this and then just basically, but it already has the other accesses, so that would basically be a bad or basically not be needed, but we'll add it anyways, basically because that makes it makes it more readable, because we might actually use some of these rules for other stuff, and then we might copy it from here, and then we want to make sure that it's the complete picture. So although this is already a lot of this stuff except the set attribute is already allowed by rules like these, we still basically we duplicate the permissions read get attribute and search, just to make sure that if we're copying this stuff in later on for other restricted processes, that we basically have the whole set, because these are patterns. All these blocks here are basically patterns that many of these graphical user applications use. Deconf temp t stuff here is basically common for all programs that are deconf aware. They all need to manage that file somehow. So that's basically why I created this block, so that at a later point when I basically confine another graphical user application, then I can basically copy this over and paste it in and have the whole picture. So that's why I basically want to make sure that I have all these permissions here, so that if I later copy it, that I can be sure that it's the stuff that I think is needed. All right, so that's basically that. Let's save and exit and make that. And as you module that. So that's pretty much everything, I think. So the bookmarks stuff probably works by now. I hope it does. This works. You can go with to the location. You can even create a folder here, but that's not going to work. I think that's not going to work. So you could probably try it, but you get an ABC denial. So because this basically this dialogue. Let's have a look at the PS out. See if how that looks, because. It's actually just Baobab here. This is the latest process, and everything seems to be still running correctly. So basically, if you try to create a folder, then access should be denied. C folder could not be created, permission is denied. And that's fine, because this shouldn't be creating folders. That's not what it's for. So 1034. So let's make that 1030. and then you'll probably see the dir right. So this is basically where the disk usage analyzer tries to create that folder that I tried to create, basically try to add a directory entry to the home directory itself. That's before it creates a file, it needs to add an entry to the parent dir, which is in this case the home my login user directory. And that's basically what's logged. And we could silently deny this, but let's not do that. We need to be conservative with don't audit rules, because you might be actually silently denying something that you would want to expose or what you want the administrator to see. So let's leave that in there. But just so you know, you won't be able to use this to create a folder. And that's fine, because that's not what it's for. And you won't be able to add a bookmark using this here, but that's not a SLinux issue or an SLinux related limitation. That's just cannot read the contents of home. That's also and that's fine, that's great, that's cool. It shouldn't be able to do that. So all in all, it seems to work, except this doesn't work, this scan remote folder stuff, because this is basically trying to connect to execute the Nautilus connect server program, and the help might probably also not work. Let's see. No, it can't execute the help application, so we can have a look at that. Trying to execute the Nautilus connect server, and it's trying to so here it's trying to actually get to the connect server application, and here you have it trying to execute the Yelp. This is basically the GNU help application, which we should basically also confine, unless you don't want to allow the user to run it. Then we can basically keep that the way it is. So that's all expected. That's just basically some stuff for later. The connect server, we want to confine that. We want to make that probably usable. But before we do that, we probably need to actually confine Nautilus itself. Because if you use Nautilus connect server, then it's probably going to want to open the remote location in Nautilus. So probably is going to try and execute Nautilus itself, and so we need to basically take care of that as well. But there's a bunch of AVC denials that I wonder why this is actually not the opens are not silently denied. So then I guess it's just. But that's fine. That's okay. So we are fine for now. And I've test out some other stuff. Like, for example, the system monitor. We confined that earlier. So that also seems to work. It's a bit slow. So let's just view preferences. Then view the file or the security context. So here you have the stuff. And let's see if we can find the processes. So here you have the sys monitor process, and where do we have our baobab process? Should be in here somewhere as well. Here's Baobab, the file system analyzer. So this is all confined, as you can see here. And it looks fine. It's that slow because of all the permissions. And of course, this is all this virtualize as well. So, but basically, if you go to the processes and try to show all processes, view all processes, then you get this stupid view where you can't basically see a lot of processes, but you can't see the kernel threads because for some reason GNOME System Monitor wants to read those. So you can read the kernel threads, and you can read some system services, like for example the ksemtuned, I think it was. And init, here's ksemtuned, you can actually read that. And init as well, probably should be somewhere in this list. Yeah, here's init. But other system services you can't actually, you know that they're there because you see these entries here, but you don't know what it is and you can't read their information. You only can see their IDs. But that's no problem, I think. So that's one nice thing you can do with mandatory access control with the centralized policy. But this all seems to work without AVC denials. Of course, you can't end processes. So if I try to end the HTTP process, then I get access denied. End process, but it's denied, permission denied. And it's getting slower. And that's probably also logged. Yeah, here you have. Oh, here we have also some stuff that we need to allow. So we need to pipe that into. But this one here actually shouldn't be allowed. This is actually the system monitor signaling the HTTP. This is basically us killing, or us trying to exit the process, signal the process. But that shouldn't be allowed. But there are some AVC denials that we need to allow. So for example, GNOME shell needs to unlink the GNOME shell data home T. And we have sysmon trying to search the GTK home T. Which is the GTK bookmarks there. So let's just nano. Actually, I can just use the history and then look for GNOME shell. G shell and then G shell data. G shell bubble. Data home. And it was actually, and I'll paste it in just to see. Data home file unlink. So yeah, it takes testing basically to iron out all the bugs, small bugs. And we have the GTK stuff. Now, I am not sure. I don't see how the sysmonitor actually uses the GTK stuff. Because there is no, far as I'm concerned, there's no tab where you can basically add some bookmarks. From that perspective, I don't see how it, but it might just need to traverse it for some reason. So I'll just add the search. Or maybe I should just add it all since it's just reading it. So, for example, if you have here the GTK, oh no, this is actually read write and stuff like that. But this here, data home T. Yeah, this is not. This is not related in the first place. This here it is. but probably this monitor. Let's have a look. Is there some way to bookmark something? I don't see. I don't see it. Anyway, where you could bookmark anything. So I'll just add search, and that's for sysmon. I'll just add search. If it needs more, we'll see later. So build that. And that's so basically need to keep testing this stuff to perfect, to make it perfect. And then we have these two things open now, already getting other stuff. People bothering me. And this is the shell. So these two three programs work. So in a sense you have some functionality yet. But we need to basically work on the remainder, other stuff. And that's basically what I'm going to do. This is allowed, this is not allowed, shouldn't be allowed. Gterm also wants to search GTK home. So this is something we need to allow. Gterm. I'll just add it below. So all these programs all need to search the bookmark stuff. Because yeah, in terminal you can actually create bookmarks. So probably terminal needs it. Okay. So let's have a look at some other stuff that we should do. So let's open the try and look for the simple stuff first. So we did these. Nautilus is a tough one. They had the foul roller might do something. Transmission to decay is probably a little bit more events. Events might be. Yeah, events is also more complicated than you'd expect, than you think. I have. Let's just do file roller. Let's just do file roller. So we can basically borrow this stuff here. This is the transition stuff. Basically, file roller is run. At least one way to run file roller is to just click it from the GNOME shell menu, and that's basically the transition from GNOME shell to file roller. So we can basically, and this is a similar transition here. So we can basically use this, copy this over, and just implement that for file roller, and then just change these this stuff here, file roller, and then just adjust it, and then we at least we have the domain transition set up properly, and then we can just basically start again with the routine, you know it, run it, test it, add the policy, test, and test some more, and just fix the issues. So yeah, file roller is our next little project. Hopefully it's a little bit simple, and hopefully it doesn't depend on Nautilus. Trying to avoid Nautilus for some reason, because I know it's just a monster. Nautilus, and basically I confined it before, I know the issues that are involved, but yeah, the Nautilus suite is just a huge suite, so all kinds of application that it's trying to execute. So this seems to be it. Save and exit, see if it builds, and then install that. Meanwhile, see if so it loaded, probably. Yeah, it did. So now basically, let's just set this in permissive mode. Let's just close out these other applications here. These confined apps. And then just set them for 0. And then just try to run this file roller thing. See if we're clean. Nothing to do, so we're clean. And then just run file roller. Archive manager, actually. So now we ran archive manager. All is well. We should see some AVC announcements with regard to file roller. And we have. But these aren't all, but these are some. Or these are, yeah. We'll just copy this over and paste them into our module. Let's search for file roller, froller, and just paste these in and just have a look at them. And we need to basically take a checklist. So let's see, is it executing anything? And it is actually executing. But just checking for execute. So this is one of those, all these programs are doing the same stuff. They're ex all executing the similar stuff. So let's just save this and let's have a look to confirm. It's executing one of those applications, and if you looked at my previous episodes, then you know which applications I'm talking about. There are some applications that GNOME just needs access to, or at least yeah, access to, and it's basically all these programs that GNOME needs access to are checking each other. They're all depending on each other, so they're checking each other for execute. So this is probably Nautilus or Events or Eye of GNOME or some of those. Grab, and I need to grab for the proper execute. Tar. This is not one of those, but it makes sen it does make sense. It does make sense, but it's I had it wrong here. This is not one of the programs that GNOME relies on. This is just tar, and it makes sense because if you run file roller runs tar on behalf of you and other gzip and stuff like that. And so basically this needs to be allowed. Basically the file roller needs to be allowed to run generic binaries, but we need to allow that later on, not right now, because we want to see if it's running any other binaries, and it does, and it is actually. We know that. Fuller. Because yeah, it needs to, for example, run gzip, or yeah, that is tar actually. But let's say unbrar. If you basically use the unrar utility to unrar a rar archive, then it needs to be able to run unrar as well, and the same goes for all other kinds of stuff that it supports. So yeah, we need to just wait with adding permissions for generic binaries, and just realize that it's going to need to run generic binaries, but it needs to run them in the Froller domain, so to speak. And basically, so it did run, or it might not have run it yet, since it's just execute and not open IO control. So it might just have, for now, it might just check for execute, just to make sure that it's executable. But even if it had executed it, we could still be confident that these rules can be allowed, since the only application executed until now, for now, by Froller is the tar program. So even if the Froller program ran tar, then the permissions needed to do that should be allowed to Froller, so we can be sure that these can all be allowed. So we basically took care of this one here. So let's just make a space here, and or let's just remove it. We know that it executes generic binaries, but we can't allow it yet. So what we need to do now next is just go through these and just make sure. So it needs to read fonts. Now all these programs need to read fonts. So we can basically just add these rules here, and that's for reading fonts. And then just go through all the whole list, and then just basically remove add it here. Reading fonts, and then just substitute that with Froller or F roller, not roller. And then just remove them from this list here, so that we know that we already included them. Deconf temp, also common. They all need to manage deconf temporary files. That's something they all have in common. Don't ask me why, because I'm not a deconf programmer, but yeah. And same goes for a lot of this stuff, by the way. So let's just add a lot of this stuff. This, at least these. Where are we? Fuller. And then Jolf. Add them here. Paste. And then just substitute them, or change the name, the domains. And then later I'll show you which, why I added those and which rules we can remove. But at some point you see patterns and then you know, oh yeah, this is what he wants to do, and this is what all these graphical user applications want to do. Interact with XServer and with XDM files, operate on XDM files, read password file. Not sure if this is needed, but we'll see, and if it is, then if it's not, then we'll remove it. But it might be. I wouldn't be surprised if it's reading the password file, and it is. Probably some library that does that. And we might be able to silently deny that, but why would we? Why would we? So, let's just start top to bottom. Deconf temp. So, the rules we added were searching user temp, which is basically the run user and then user ID, and then there's a config there in there, and that wants to basically create a file in there. And so these rules can be removed. This one, and then there's a user home key, but you can't see it in this list because, oh yeah, here it is, user temp key get attribute. So that's taking care of this stuff here. Now we have the tempfs read write, the inherited generic tempfs. This is XServer, an XServer quirk. And here you have foreign T file, the PIT file of XDM, and stream connecting to XServer, something that all of them do. So here we have that PIT file and that stream connect, so we can remove those as well. And then you have here that JTK home search. That's what all these programs do. They all basically searching that bookmark stuff. Okay, let's go on and look for some more common stuff. So with FST get attribute of file system, they all do, it seems. So here it is. Add that as well. We took care of the oh yeah, let's remove this one as well. So here you can see that Ibis stuff that Baobab Web also did. Here that Ibis config, so we can basically copy this over. This was Ibis config, yeah, Ibis config. So and add that here, and then change that name. Because it didn't show everything, but we know that it needs all this stuff. All Ibis config. And then we have some stuff with regard to deconf config home t, which also everyone wants. And that recently used stuff also. So we need to actually add all these rules as well. So let's just add these as well. Recently used, here you have it. And now it's just reading, but if you're basically, it basically also needs to add recently used stuff. If you're basically creating some archive or extracting some archive, then it needs to be able to add a recently used entry file. So yeah, you can just allow that. And then remove that from the list. This one here. So we got that, and then we have the deconfig stuff. This is this. This is that, and we also need this here. So let's just. Oh, actually, we shouldn't use that from here. So let's just use that from gsys monitor, or from here. Need to be careful that we use the that we don't use stuff that we don't want to use. So. So here, let's just do this stuff here. This is stuff that it wants. So add that below there. Oh, actually, here. Paste that in and just change it. Fuller. Fuller, because all these apps do the same stuff. They're all using some GNOME library or a set of GNOME libraries. So yeah, and then we can remove some of this stuff. So config home, search and get attribute, which is basically here. Data home, it wants to read. Search and get attribute data home dir, so it's actually reading data home dir here. Wonder why that is. We need to be careful here. Do not allow, because what you did here, what it might have done here is basically, well, this is a bad example, but this, some of this stuff might be related to some of the missing type transition rules that we had. So let's just allow for now the search and get attribute of data home dirs, but not allow the read. The deconf home search read, but yeah, so that's basically allowed here. So we can also, and then the deconf home get attribute and home root get attribute, which basically is this and this stuff here, basically traversing home root and user home dir to get to period local and then period local share and then a period config and period config deconf. So that's all stuff that makes sense and can be allowed by assumption. And then you have basically it's connecting to dbus. And this is also something that we already allowed. So we have a few more things left. So dbus system bus for live G. So what else does the system bus for live G then? So never mind the background noise, they're working. So it might actually do this here, but oh, this is far run, so this is not related. Let's see if we can find some dbus far live related stuff. for a run, that's not it. Why would these programs? Yeah, here we have similar for sysmon, does the same thing. So we can copy this over and use that. And it's basically just traversing. Not sure why it is traversing, but it's just traversing. And this makes sense. So it's nice if you basically keep these rules grouped. Because yeah, you need to be able to search var lib to get to system dbsd var lib. So all these rules are, makes sense. So yeah. Can now just five. Oh, no. Don't mess up. Okay, so it's connected to the user bus. That means that actually, and do we have other programs that connect to the user bus? Yeah. So this actually means that it's dbus chatting. Pretty sure of that. So let's have a look. And do first the audit to allow user AVC, see if it's chatting to some system services. No, it doesn't. And then basically see if it's, and it's chatting to session services. So till n, and I'll just make that 400 just to make be sure var log messages, and then audit to allow to see to which session services it's chatting. So it's actually acquiring service on the bus or session bus, and then it's basically chatting to fsp, dconf, gshell, gvfs for now. Let's just make sure that there aren't any processes, although I'm pretty sure grep, but it doesn't hurt to just check that there aren't any processes running in the wrong domain. It all seems to be running right. So yeah, that's fine. Open the file. Frawler, and then just add these dbus related stuffs in there. I'll just add these below, and you know how that works by now. You should know how it works by now. These are basically two-way communications. This is a one-way communication. It's chatting to the session bus, user session bus, and then acquiring service. And this is two-way. Oops. And this is two-way. Round trip, so to speak. Don't have to do that, but and this is two way. So now we have some, and then we basically need to do the same stuff with the don't audit removed and in enforcing mode to get these the stuff that you don't see usually. Yes. Build, make. And install. about IRC. All right. Yeah, if you file a bug, then you should be prepared to test stuff and stuff like that. Nice that people are so cooperative. So DB to unload, silent, denounce. And then send a force after we close up. But so let's close this one up. And let's just should have done that earlier. Oh, this is not it. If some other stuff is done with regard to closing it, if there's other HTML that we missed. So this is not allowed, but we don't want to allow it currently. This is allowed, but this isn't allowed, and we want to basically see why that's happening. It's allowed. Yeah, seems everything currently is allowed. So let's just set in force one and work on taking care of the non-obvious issues, the issues that are hidden. So now you'll see that it probably won't execute, won't run. Oh, it actually does run. So let's see what we got. It's only the expected stuff. So that means that we have some nice templates now to build on. So let's just see if we can figure out why it's reading that data home dir and which dir is that. So it's actually reading the share directory, the local share directory. So we should just allow that. But it's just, so here you have some of the stuff that it executes. Zip, zip info, tar, these kind of programs. But you see, because we didn't allow the executable bin, now we have a chance to actually see what all it's trying to execute, except tar. So that's why we don't allow it. We want to basically leave that to the last, so that we can actually see what it all needs to execute. But we need to allow this read for data home tweeters, because that's something that is specific to file roller, obviously. A file roller wants to read data home dirs. So we have the file roller datum dir, and we'll just allow read. Not sure why, but it wants it. So let's just make that. And everything else seems to be in order. For now. Until you start doing something. Because now, eventually, we just want to be sure to create an archive and to extract an archive. So we need to think about some of the design decisions that we're about to make. So, basically, we should decide, should file roller be able to create archives of any of the home content. So for example, should I be able as a user to basically create an archive of the period config there as a confined user? Or should I just be able to create an archive of user home content, generic user home content? So for example, content in the desktop directory or the documents directory. Now, basically, it's probably better that we allow FileRouter to basically create archives of all user home content, including the configs and stuff like that. Even actually the SSH keys and the GPT keys and stuff like that. Because, well, a lot of this stuff can read anyways, well, not the SSH key, but it can actually read, for example, config, a lot of stuff in period config and the IBIS data or cache something. I'm not sure what it was, but I'm just saying that it can already read some of the stuff, the configuration stuff. So then you'll, if you basically don't allow that, then you'll get that it's able to extract some stuff but not all of it, and that's ugly, and we don't want to basically cripple the user. It's the user's content, so we might just allow it to do everything. So you have this open box here. Let's just set a 4.0 and just click that open box and see what happens. So we get this dialogue again, and then basically we get all this stuff again, which was also for our file system analyzer. Same, basically the same stuff but then different. So you got this recently used stuff here. So we basically need to add support for GTK Home, so we can basically already do that. So let's just do that, because it's just the way it is. So there's this GTK stuff, and we did search for now, but it's doing a lot more than just searching. So GTK, what do we have here for GTK? Where's my GTK stuff for Baobab? Here, this is it. So basically we need to add this all. And same with the recently used. Oh, actually, recently used, we need to take care of that. But we already have, haven't we? We probably already have, yeah. But we should probably also be able to make bookmarks. Yeah, the recently used, we already took care of that. But we also need to... Well, I'm not going to make any assumptions, though. I'm not going to make any assumptions. So, but a lot some stuff that we know that it should do is basically read all user content. So this here, we can allow instead of this. Yeah. And then there's more stuff. Now, unlike this here, unlike this here, you need to do that differently. So I'll explain to you what I'm thinking about. So basically what we allow here above is, basically we allow, and we need to change this file roller. We need to allow file roller to basically traverse /home. And then it should be able to read the user home directory and any user content directories in the user home directory. So any, also the config stuff, cache stuff, SSH stuff, anything. And then basically, on top of that, it should basically be able to read everything there on behalf of the user. So to get here is the following. We can basically do this here. Remove the search. Something like this. So this is for file. Should be able to read any file in the user home directory, but also a SOC file, any SOC file. Although doesn't really make sense to have a socket. Well, it does. Whether you want to basically add that in your archive is another issue. FIFO, so name pipes, FIFO file, link files. Now we already took care of DIRS. Link file. No. Character files. Yeah, what the heck. Also, create, add those to your archive. Block files. Doesn't make sense, but. So now we basically have. So, probably about all of the objects. File objects, so you should be able to read them all, everything. And not sure if it needs IO control, but we'll see later. So now basically it should be able to create content. Now basically what we need to do is basically, so now it can read everything in the user home directory. Basically, probably something like that. We should see. But now basically, so it can create a archive of anything in the user home directory. Now basically we need to allow it to actually create that archive in the user home directory itself. So we need a transition here. So we need to basically allow my login user file roller t, and then user home t, we need to be able allow it to manage actually any confined application should be able to manage generic home content. And then just get attribute, read, write, open, IO control, create, stuff like that. And then we need to basically allow user home directory, allow this file roller to basically add their entries to the user home dir add name. And then we should allow a type transition and then my login user file roller, and then from type transition, so if the user creates a file in the user home dir, then create that file with the generic user home content type, user home t. Yeah, that's it. And that's a little bit sucky, because now the user can basically, the file roller can basically declassify user home content on behalf of the user, but okay. And that's basically what we also need to do, and that's basically what we already did here, but we also need to add some other permissions. And this is basically user home too. Because we also need to allow file roller to be able to create archives in, for example, the desktop or documents there. So that's basically why it also needs to be able to add names to generic user home types, besides also the user home there. So that's basically what that allows. So it can read all user home content, and it can actually create files with the generic user home file type, and then it can also transition from the user home dir to the user home generic user home content type. So if it creates an archive in its user home directory, then that archive gets created with the proper user home content type, and it can also create content in generic user home content type dirs, and that doesn't need a transition, because that'll happen automatically. Alright, so it seems we have these rules in place. Let's see if this builds. And it doesn't. We have a syntax error at type transition. So where is? Roller. And go to the type transition rule. So what's wrong there? Oh, this is it. We neglected to close it. Okay, now we have some permissions that are not allowed. So let's, the open is not allowed for FIFO. Open is not allowed for class. Open is not allowed for SOC. And open is not allowed for block. Weird. So let's just do this the hard way. Where are we? Here, this is where it's complaining about, this one. So what we're going to do is we're just going to make 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. One more. And then we're going to tune that up. So the first is just a file. Second is a SOC file. Third is a FIFO file. FIFO. And fourth is a link. And the fifth is a character device node. Character file. And then the last one, and we turned out we had one. We missed one. It's a block file. Alright. So now we need to go back and have a look as what it was. So open is not for FIFO file, and it's not for link file, and it's not for SOC file. So go back. It's not for FIFO file, SOC file, and link file. Weird. I thought it, but it doesn't actually open those. And then, let's see. It's also not for block file. But it is for character file. Weird. So let's just see. This should be it then. Yep. I didn't know that the open permission did not apply to block files and FIFO files and link files. I knew for link files. I noticed that. Alright. So now we have that stuff in place. So now in theory, if it's, let's see if we're getting force, if we're very permissive. So in theory, I could basically see what happens if I create an archive. So I'll cancel this one out and open a shell. Well, actually, let's just not do that. Let's just open and create an archive. Actually, it's not showing everything, but you can probably make it show everything. Show hidden files. And let's just create an archive of SSH. Open. There's nothing in there. That's weird. There should be something in there. Okay, let's just try this one. New. Test. Location. Other options. Buffer. Other, open, whoops, let's see. Didn't I actually create it or did it? Anyways, let's just have a look at AFC now, so that we don't forget that. Yeah, TTK. So it's actually doing that TTK stuff here, so we need to allow that. So we need to allow the DTK stuff as well. can borrow that from Baobab. And then instead of this, use this. And then change the name. Okay. Now we need to be careful here. Although, not really. But why didn't it create an archive? The hell? That's weird. Yeah. Because it was empty, I just didn't know how to use it. Probably. Be damned. Where did it create that stuff? Crazy or probably am. Wow, here is some stuff going on that we're getting messy. File roller is reading, yeah, that's fine. But we need to basically look at the execute. Something is getting executed. A lot of stuff is getting executed. So these are all these commands that it needs to execute file roller. And then we have this one here. This is actually a dependency that we need to take care of. So it's getting more complicated again, guys. It's getting more complicated. So nano, my login user, file context file. Then DVFS, I'll just add it below. And then what do I call this DVFS stuffies? DVFS. Yeah, DVFS, the metadata, just the full word. DVFS, the metadata. So I'll just call that DVFS, the metadata. Save and exit. And then click the type enforcement file, and then all the way below, add that. And I add the transition. So we need to basically, it's a DBus transition. So let's just have a look at other DVS stuff. Fuzzy is getting executed, but this one here. This is applicable. So yeah, it's getting more complicated because it's running actually running something else. And that was expected. At some point you get these dependencies. It starts with a few dependencies, and then these few dependencies get a few more dependencies, and then these dependencies of these dependencies get a few more dependencies, and before you know it, you're basically open up a whole can of worms. It happens. But that's all part of the job. So at least we have that transition out of the way. Even built, install it, and then make sure that you basically restore the context of the metadata executable file. But I have no clue where I created that file, that gzip, tar-gz, v. I have no clue. Resolve the home, my login. Can't see, find it. Test location, my login user, add file. out. So this actually also needs to run Nautilus. So now it's getting really ugly. But actually, so there should be the TARDIS. Yeah, it's actually in there. So why doesn't this list that? Oh, now it does. And it's created with the right type. Anyway, so we just can't use this stuff. We really need to just RF this or RM this and just log out. Oh. Because now this stuff is getting really messy. So we need to log out. Do our little clear directory kill all processes dance. So we have a kill all you my login user. And we have a what is it? Clear my login user shell. And then we have a temp clearance. RMRF temp. Get that up. Okay, so that's that. Let's see if we clean with audits. And then just make sure that you don't execute Nautilus next. We're clear. Okay, let's log in. Oops. Not this shit again. Oh, no. It's worse. Okay. So we're opening it up. Creating a new archive. We call it test archive. Create that. Add some files. Let's view all files. SSH. Add them. Then have a look at the stuff here. Close. That's so weird. Oh, it already created it. Cancel. Cancel. So it seems it already created it. Yeah, it did. Okay, let's see what ABC else we have. This is all unrelated. This. Let's just grab Frawler. Yes. So we have Frawler executing tar. That's cool. Then we have it appends XDM, which can ignore. And then it's writing to SSH home file. That's so weird. Enter. And this is needs to rename. Rename. So it actually creates this stuff with a random suffix, prefix. And actually, it creates a dir. So now you know how, you can see how that works, that stuff. So it actually needs more. It needs a file transition for user home t and user home dir t for also for dir, it's not just files. Thriller. So we have this file transition here for files, but we need to also do this for dirs file and dir. And then use home. Get it with the read the write the open the messy. So we have a create the open the write the add name. I bet. Search probably. Actually, that those are all allowed already. So let's just start with create. And now we have that file that needs to be renamed. Name for file, remove name for user home dirty. So yeah, it needs to basically also remove name. Let's have a look at more ABC denials, not these. Just these, except for this write, this is too stupid. Why the fuck will I allow it to write? Maybe it's just checking for write. Okay, let's it's messy. Actually, we can extend this here. So that's basically silently denying write on, because I don't know why it needs to write there. And then just allow outed access. So I'm just assuming that it just tries to open for write or something like that. So I'll just do this. Okay, not loud for care. Car FIFO link sock file block file. Car FIFO link sock block. Damn. And that's makes sense. So file the car file. Car file also not. Annoying how this works. Annoying indeed. I don't understand why that piece of shit program wants to write to these files. That's just so doesn't make sense. Unknown class create. Oh yeah, that's right. And then I basically get into some panic mode and start making stupid mistakes. There. So always stay cool. Don't lose your temper. Because it'll just cause more errors and make your life harder than it already is. And remember to just keep enjoying it, because if it's going a drag, then that won't help. Just take your time. Okay, let's get back and let's have a look at some agency denials. But these are all unrelated. Unrelated, unrelated, unrelated. Except then, for example, this stuff here. And let's see if we have some stuff related to GVFS metadata. Yeah, we do. And do we have dbus stuff? Does dbus execute even more? Nope. So we're going to have a look at metadata. Now we're actually working on two modules at the same time. It's actually executing itself. Oh, no, actually not. I made a typo here. That's what it is. Well, basically not a typo, but I basically forgot something. So that's this one here. Now this stuff, global SSP, that's something that we don't do. So it's creating a dir in data local share, and it's creating a file in there. So let's have a look. Grab meta data. Could basically so here's creating that dir GFSD metadata dir, and inside there it's probably also creating a file. Yeah. First things first, let's have a look at that. Home. My login user, local share, GFSD metadata, here we have it. So we need to take care of that. FC, local share, and I'll just copy this over. So I'll call this metadata data home key. Go to the type enforcement file. Create a type. Then just basically classify this type out. So type attribute. And it's a file type. But also a user home type. And then I'm going to borrow some stuff from someone else who also creates stuff in data home key. And that's GNOME shell, for example. G shell. G shell creates data home content. I saw that because I borrowed the file context from G shell. So here we have it. So that's this one. So let's go all the way down and just adjust that. Oh, see if we have a file type transition there as well. Yeah, we basically forgot that. Just add that below. All right. Now we just edit this to reflect our situation here. So first of all, we're having this DVFS metadata. I'll just do it like that. So it's not clean shell in this case. So now all of a sudden, we started with file roller, but now all of a sudden we're doing DVFS. DVFSD as well. That's how it goes sometimes. You have these dependencies and all metadata home to so. And it's also it's about a file in the dir, so we basically can just do that. Shouldn't make it. And then it's DVFS, D metadata, I think it was. DVFS, D metadata. I think. And then we can remove these. And these. This one. And the home, yeah, of course, it needs to be able to search home and use home dir. So we can basically borrow that. This one, not this one. Sucks. This one. We can borrow this. Because yeah, to be able to get there, you need to traverse this stuff here. So yeah. And then we can remove these two. Oh. This, see, sometimes I'm just pressing the wrong keys. It happens. And this can be removed as well. Now we know from looking at this rule here that it's also probably have getting a service on the in the session bus. So there's a tail var and 100 var log messages and an either to allow. We can take care of that as well. So this here yeah, we have a bunch of stuff. So we have also more stuff with regard to file roller. Let's first things first. File roller is chatting to metadata. So in other words, metadata is chatting to file roller. That messy now. Okay. This one is single, and this is double, or two-way, single-way, one-way and two-way. Copy that. Alright, that should take care of that. And then this, accept the metadata, we don't need that. And then just add that to the debug stuff here. So we can remove the metadata because we already took care of that, but we need to take care of these. I can just do it here. So it's heavily communicating with GVFS. Another. Oh man. Messy indeed. Keep typing the wrong key combinations, and then Nano is doing stuff that I don't want it to do. Let's try this again. Hopefully. It's a bit dark in my house. Should probably just make sure that I have a light. So the AFC form one, we already took care of that. And you just mom. So at least we took care of this stuff. Then just basically go over it all over again. Test, 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 and keep testing it. Oh, and I see a bug already. Actually, it's not GVFS the metadata, it's GVFS metadata. It's so stupid also with a GVFSD. Sometimes it uses a GVFSD, sometimes GVFS. Just not. Intuitive. Just not intuitive. But oh well. Whatever. Have to deal with that. But let that be a lesson to you and your policy. Try to be as consistent as possible. Alright, so log out. or first log in to be able to log out. And just clear the stuff that we so it's kill all you my login user and it's clear my login user shell and then it's remove damn directory. Then let's see, out search mavcts1220. We're not clear how to allow 21. Now we're clear. All right, log in and just do this stuff all over again. So let's open up the file roller and new archive, I guess. I call this test created, add a file, and has it been created? Yep, it's been created. So less that because there's a shitload of APC denials. This is all expected. This is all expected. This is all expected, but this here. Oh, we should have been taking care of this and basically there's a don't audit rule for here for this stuff, so we can basically ignore that. This is all done. 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 And here we have metadata actually reading and opening the metadata data home T. This is something we should take care of. But other than that, and here we have Checkminer doing some stuff. That's fine. So two things: tracker miner fs and what was it? Metadata. So let's just do metadata first. So there was this stuff with regard to file, I guess it was, wasn't it? Read open. Other. And then track miner fs. Tr miner fs. User home t. Miner is mining. Yep. dir, and it, this is actually related to foul. And it's actually, I can basically probably, I'll just do it this way though. Regratitude open geostl, let's see. Read lock open. It's actually read lock open. Read lock open. Let's just also have a look at that. See if it's expected. Grab user home t, because I think it's probably the tar-tzip that is messing with, and it's indeed actually messing with the tar-tzip. It's mining it. So yeah, that's fine. Let's have a look at some of the stuff that we changed. Let's first see if the process is running the proper domains, and then also confirm that the stuff in data is labeled properly. So ps out z grep 1012. So we have metadata running, we have file roller running, and this all seems to be running in the proper domain. Doesn't it? Abort epitop manifest. Yeah, it seems to be running fine. Yeah, it's all running in the right domain. So let's also, let's all see home, my login user. So we have this tar gzip created in the user home directory, and it transitioned properly to the generic user home content type, which is the idea. And then let's have a look at local share. So the DVFS metadata dir is now also protected. That's fine. Let's have a look at stuff like caching config. Is it still all confined? Seems to be all still confined in cache. Now let's have a look at config. And that all seems to be confined. Yep, that's all confined as well. Oh, SSH, and that's all fine as well. So let's just try this out again, but then in enforcing mode. It's 2.9 right now. We're clear. Set enforce 1. See if we can actually close this down. Seems to be closing. Then let's just open it up again. And it's opening. This is opening. Create a new archive. Call this test 1. And instead of creating it in the my login user, we'll create it in desktop. Create it, add a file, SSH. Now let's just create cache. And it's done. Okay, let's have a look at AFC denials. And here we have a lot of Now the weird thing is, and Chuck Minor assesses shit and he's a hunter. Humpty does. So we need to allow that as well. Where is TR minor FS? Search. Okay, what's happening with file roller? See, file roller is riding to Durs like a dog in heat, and it's probably checking right. Let's just check out the execute. Weird thing is that, see, all these programs, so we can just basically allow it. These are really all generic programs that it's running. It's not running anything that should transition. So we can really basically allow it to execute Binti. Although, not quite. Because, as you can maybe remember, here's this screen here. And when you click this one here up the location, then it's going to open it up in Nautilus. Now fortunately Nautilus does have a private type already, so if I allow it to execute generic binaries, then that won't affect Nautilus, because Nautilus is not a generic binary currently. So in that sense, yet I want to have a look. So we're in a forcing mode, aren't we? Get enforce. We are enforcing. So if it can't run tar or anything, then how can it create this archive? That's just weird. This is weird. That's just weird. That doesn't make sense. How was it able to create that? That file. If it's not allowed to execute generic binaries, then how can it actually run tar? That doesn't make sense. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. I know what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to basically allow it to check for execute. So we have Froller, and I'll allow Froller to check execute on Binti. So in here I'll add the following: don't audit Froller bin execute, and then just allow it audit access. Because, as far as I'm concerned, it's just checking for execute. Because if it was actually running this binary, then I would see an execute no trans, or even an open or a get attribute. But it just seems to be just checking a list of various programs and see if they're executable for some reasons. So let's just save and exit that, and make that, build that, and then just start all over again and act like I'm stupid and just try it out. It could be related to metadata. It could be related to metadata. So I'm going to basically log out. Yeah. And then I'm going to kill all. You, my login user. And then I'm going to clear my login user shell. And then I'm going to ls to get rid of pulse audio. RM, RF, temp. So if I don't do that, then pulse audio might choke and that'll might fail, prevent us to log in. In a previous episode, we had that where we at some point we were just not able to log into GNOME anymore. And I thought, how could that be? Because previously I was always able to log in, and only a couple of things changed, and now all of a sudden I can't log in anymore. And then after like an hour or so trying and basically having no clue what's going on, I just figured that it might have been related to Pulse, because Pulse is really, for a sound server, it's an important server, so to speak, service, but it really does some nasty things. It really is just one big hack to be able to do what it does. And so if you, for example, just remove a config file of Pulse, and you log out and you log in, or you try to log in, then you might not be able to log in because there's some corruption going on, some file missing or stuff like that. And there's some other issues with regard to pools as well, so you really need to be careful. So if you're basically at some point not able to log in and you don't see any AVC denials, then and it works in permissive mode but not in forcing mode, then it may just be related to pools. Then just clear all the pool stuff and try again, and then it might just work. Okay, let's have a look. And we're at 3:09 right now, 10 minutes later. Oh yeah, we should basically remove that tar gzip file. RM home my login user and then test tar gzip. Yep. And ls all and I'll stop ls all. It shouldn't be there anymore. Oh, not ld, ls, no directory. All right, so get enforce, we're enforcing. We still do have SE module DB enabled. We're clear from AVC denials, so let's just log in and act like we don't know anything. So we logged in. And we're just going to create an archive, because that's what we do. So we create an archive, my archive, and we're creating it in the user home directory, and then we're just adding files. Let's just say our bsrc. And okay, so let's have a look. This is all expected. Expected. So you have that stuff. This is all. It seems to just work. I don't have a clue. Something is running Tar on our behalf. It's so weird. Now we don't have any AFC denials with regard to metadata, it seems. Can't find any. Is metadata running? Yeah, it's running. So not much new. But don't ask me why this thing is allowed to create a archive, but it isn't actually allowed to execute tar or anything. It must be sending some debug message to something else, and something else must be creating it. I have no other explanation for that. So let's just close this up. And let's just see how clean we are currently. At 4.3. Nothing. Let's just open it up. And open, and it's actually in there. And still nothing to do. And we're enforcing. So I know what's going on. All right, so let's see if we have user AFC denials. No, we don't. Till and 100. Still, I'm not saying. See if we have no, we have no debug related stuff either. So what we need to take care of is this stuff. I'm expecting AVC denials like mad. kind of is. That's so weird as well, that it's actually good. So that's actually something is denied. That is a relief. That is a relief. Okay, let's just try another archive and use zip. This doesn't make sense to me. New. And here we have an error. So what's happening here is that 7-zip is using temp instead of home. So whereas for tar it's just creating a dir in the user home directory and then just unlinking it later on, but 7-zip or whatever it's called is actually using temp. The weird thing is though that it's, let's have a look. What's that pool? I don't know what that pool command is. Why it's running in the file roller. Domain. All right, so let's take care of that. Or at least try it first. Set and four zero. And see what it's trying to create. So, new. Blah. Create. Replace. Add files. Ah, pouch, and don't search now because then it will search package kit, use package kit. Are you kidding me? Yeah, this is, I haven't installed that. What else can I zip? I do have zip, don't I? So it's creating, and here we have an execute no chance actually, and we have a reproc, so we have some stuff here. Let's do the execute no chance first. Oh, it was denied to execute 7-zip. So it actually was installed, but it couldn't get to it. So let's take care of that first. So, Froller. So basically, we should take get rid of this one here and just allow it. And then just execute no trance. This is actually running the 7-zip binary. Let's just have a look all the way up what is needed to run a file. To be honest, let's have a look. SE search, allow source domain, target binti, and then just grab binti. Grab domain. So here you have it. This is a rule that's added to Fedora, and it's very coarse, and it sucks really. But what it says is that it's already allowed to do anything else with bin. It just needs to execute and execute no chance. So we took care of that. Next we have file roller actually executing shell. You're kidding me, right? And yeah, it's actually just running a shell. Grab shell. File roller is actually running bash. So that sucks. So we have this rule where we allow it to execute bin, but it also needs to execute shell. Exactly. And why? Because it wants to execute a shell, it's going to need a whole crap load of other permissions as well. Like, for example, read proc D, which is basically mem info. It's reading mem info. Now the difference here is that proc D is probably a read-only file as well. So let's just have a look. So proc D, so let's just search domain, and then instead of bin T use proc D. So it's actually already allowed to search the DIRS, but it just needs permission to... Let's have a look at sysfst. And it's already allowed to search. But it wants to actually also list it, read it. So let's just copy this stuff over. And then go to Froller. And then just add that stuff in there. I'll just add it below where it executes shell because it's kind of related. And I'll just remove this one and this one and leave these in. And then we need a new type. I'll add that below type. Roller temp, and that is a roller temp G is a file type. A temp file type. And a user temp type. Then I'll have a look what it's trying to create. A file. It was a file actually. So I'll just copy these over. Add it all the way on top. So what we have here is it's listing that there, and then basically Froller temp, and then a type transition. It's creating a file in temp. So we need to make sure that it creates that with a type transition. And needless to say, it's also going to need to be able to search and probably get attributes of temp-tethers. You can't create something in a temp-tether if you can't traverse it. Add name, remove name, makes sense. Write makes sense. The read, I guess it wants to list it. It kind of sucks though, because that enables you to list temp. And then we have use home key related stuff. Let's see what that's all about. Grab use home key. So that's basically that 7-zip file that it's trying to unlink, and it's trying to remove a generic dir. So yeah, we need to allow these two. I'll just copy these over. And then open the file again and go to Froller. And then where it's user temp t. Oh, user home t, I'm sorry. So here we have that. Let's just paste this in here just to have a look. So it wants to remove a user home t dir, rm dir. Rm dir. And unlink the user home file. And of course, inside that dir, it wants to do all kinds of stuff as well. That seems obvious. Okay, make F. It's going to require a lot of testing this. A lot of testing. Close this. Log out. And kill all you, my login user. Then clear my login user shell. And then ls all z temp. And then rm rf. Temp and then the file, but also ls all z home my login user, because there's stuff in there that we need to remove. We have test 1-zip. Yes, we have blah 7-zip 7-z whatever it is, and we have yep, and we have my archive and then go back and list it again. We're clean. Okay, I'll search MAGTS 1306. We're clean, but run that to other to allow anyways, so that we don't have to type that later. Alright, get enforce, set enforce 1, login, let's see where this gets us. So we're in a forcing mode right now. So, new test, and it's a 7-zip. We're going to try a 7-zip. Create, add files, list over everything, and add base RC to it. And that seems to work. And there's a test 70 file there. Let's close this. Let's open up. Let's see if we can extract that file. Extract that to desktop. Show files, don't click this one because that probably shouldn't be allowed anyways. Yeah. Can't execute Nautilus. So that's cool. So let's have a look. Desktop. And there's that BASIC file extracted. And it has the proper type. Let's have a look at our search. We have some stuff here. Wants to set attributes of user home defaults. This should be allowed. So let's just do that. Furler. And then user home T where it's managing user home key files, set attribute. Oops, set attribute. And that probably goes for DIRs and stuff as well. So let's just try it. Oh, let's clean this up. This goes for this as well. So let's just try another one. So let's create a new archive. Blah. And we make this a zip. Create it. And I add stuff, but now we're going to add full directories in there, but don't add the bash. And now we have errors. Let's have a look. And that's basically because it needs to do with DIRs, generic home DIRs as well. Oh, and actually that's not even related. We have this one here, so let's add that as well. This one is using TempFS. Now let me guess, it's creating that stuff on TempFS. It's basically doing stuff all over the place. So let's try that again. Let's see what we got now. And some of the stuff is silently night. Oh, actually, I need to load this up as well, though. Because I can just add it, but that doesn't mean... If it can't get attributes of TempFS, then it probably just craps out. So that's probably related, and not so much the don't audits. Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. We'll see. All right, let's try this again. Let's see what we have. Oh, less that because there's a lot of stuff. this TempFS get attribute, which actually. Weird. That's odd. This is silently denied. Let's have a look. Let's have a look. Just not saying anything, but what it tells us is that it actually that right so it might actually let's just wait let's just till and 100 far log messages audit to allow nothing there, so it must be related to it writing to cache home, set enforce 0 and try this again. Have a look. There we go. It's actually this one is actually caching. So there's less that. This one is actually using the cache directory. So Really, they're all using some something else. So we're just creating a file where it looks cache. Transition. And we can't use a file named named file transition. But we can do some stuff because we have this fr here. So dot fr dash. Dot fr dash, and let's just copy this over and then just take care of that. So fc, and then basically cache home dir. Okay. And then it's basically fr this stuff here, and then this, and this is a dir, and then system view object r. Now that really makes sense, I guess. Or yeah, might make sense though. For all our cache MT to basically confine this stuff, but it might make sense. You want your cache to be protected. Save and exit that, and then TE, and then go to for all our. And then create a type. And I'll do this below here. Type Froller cache MT. And this is a file type. And they use our own type. And then basically paste this in, and then just have a look at the how this goes. So basically there are some stuffs here. So this is actually temporary dir. So the create an RM dir, so I'll just copy this. The create an RM dir shouldn't be allowed for generic cache. Because what it does is it creates that period fr dash something directory in cache. So it needs to be able to add and remove dir entries, since that dir is really just temporary. It's and then inside there, it needs to, where it created that dir, that froller dir, cache dir, it needs to create a file in there. So it also needs to add entries to the froller cache home t dir. And it needs to be able to remove that dir and to create it. And then inside there it has a fuller cache file. So we need a type transition here. And it goes for fuller. And then it's cache MT in cache MT, type transition in cache MT. But it's for a dir only. And that's transition to question two. We cannot use a named file transition, unfortunately, since it's a random name. At least the random suffix. They all start with the period fr dash, but after that it's all random. So yeah, save and exit that. Make it. Install it. And then just go all over again, and hopefully I might be able to finish this episode soon. I don't have to make it perfect in this episode, just so that the basics work. Doesn't have to be perfect. We'll perfect it as time goes by. But at least you want to be able to do the zip stuff and the we also don't want to basically want to make it too ugly. So yeah, we need to basically take care of some of this stuff. Home, my login, user, and then remove. See, it wasn't able to remove these temporary files earlier. RM, RF, home, my login, user, and then all this FR. So, but it's ugly because it creates these FR dirt all over the place, it seems. So that's not nice. And then zip and 7Z. It creates these dirt all over the place. Okay, as in module B. And then enforcing, and then just go over this stuff all over again. Instead of just using it in one place, it's just creating it in the user home dirs, in temp dirs, in cache dirs, all over the place. Set and force one. I'll search to see that we're clean at 24, and we're clean. Log in, and hopefully we're not getting too many. Would be nice for a change. Oh, files, yeah, no. I clicked the wrong thing, I guess. I clicked the wrong button. Hello. I'll make this a zip because I think that the zip uses the proper place. Add files. This is cool. So far so good. Close this one up. Do it again, and now for 7Z. Damn, I keep clicking the wrong icon. Why don't I get ABC the Nals? So, new. This time I'm calling it 7-zip. Blah, test one. Just give it a name. Add files. So far so good. LS all Z home my login user. So I created these two. Let's have a look at cache. All looks fine in cache. LS all Z temp. All looks fine in temp. Get enforced. Reinforcing. Let's extract some of this stuff. And don't click the wrong icon. Open. And I'm just going to extract it 7V. Open that. And extract that. But extract it to my desktop there. Close. Have a look at that. Have a look at ABC denials. This, I thought I actually allowed that. But it's also for there. And that makes sense. User home tigers, where are you? User home tigers. Set attributes. Ah, always the same. And it needs much more, of course. Oh, I'm pretty sure it needs much more. Make F. SE module. But let's also have a look to see if it's all actually extracted to the desktop there. Takes a long while. So where do I have my LS? And then desktop. So it did extract the stuff here, SSH. And it did extract. Alright. So that stuff works. Let me just do something different though. Open a shell. So this is all in enforcing mode, by the way. And let me just start my file. Well, let's just make it seek 100. My file bin. LS, and we have my file bin, and then just use the file manager to actually extract that. So new, and I'll just make this a tar gzip. My file, create, and add that my file, not this. Not this, but this. Add it. Close this. and I'll remove the my file bin. It's gone, but we do have the tar-g zip right here now, so let's just extract the tar-g zip to the user home directory, see if that works. Open, extract, and just extract it here. Close, ls, and we're back. Let's see what AV signals we get with regard to this stuff. Nothing. So now let's add some more. So we had with our baobab, we had this rule where we basically said, okay, you can go to home, but you can't mess with any system stuff, and that's this one here. Copy this over, and then just add that to our file roller, and then just put that. Only user content, and then make that fuller. It might be a bit too early for this, but nonetheless, I'm going to have to stop this episode because it's taking way too long. These applications are. Yeah, they have so much functionality that SE module B to silently deny. They have so much functionality that you really need to at some point need to say, okay, now pause. But I want to basically take care of each of these applications in one episode, so it's basically conflicting. Should not do that. Okay, we're enforcing. I'll search MAVCTS1334, order to allow. We're clean. All right. So let's just open up. And let's just open and try this. Not allowed. Now this is allowed. This sucks. We have to allow it because it wants that. This is also allowed. This is allowed by Fedora policy. This is not allowed, fortunately. This is allowed. But can't get the root. Can't get the root because doesn't even see it. This works. Let's see if we have IAVC now. And here we have actually opening vim10.2. See if someone else does that, and if so, why? It's a dir. This is not. This is all. This is about a file. Which file is that? Yeah. It's 5 log. I don't know what it is. I'll just ignore this for now. But it looks pretty cool. It seems to work for at least for a large extent, so. See, it's the search functionality seems to work. Yep. So that's nice. Recently used seems to work. That's nice. So the functionality works. And let's just create a extract this, but not to the to download. And don't open it, because if you show the files, then that will be denied. You see? But it just can't actually execute Nautilus. So that's not allowed. But it's it did actually extract it. So it's there. So yeah, I guess this this is it. There's probably many more bugs in there. You can't actually use the help functionality. And it's actually basically crapping the hell out. Instead of just a nice ABC denial, it's actually just doing nasty stuff. Oh, and that's right. You know why that is? Because we allowed FileRoller to execute generic binaries for the 7-zip, tar-gzip stuff, and for the zip stuff. But Yelp, which is the GNOME help program, is also still generic. So FileRoller was allowed to execute it. However, FileRoller did not have all the permissions required to run Yelp properly. So for example, it seems that the exact man permission was required to run Yelp. But since the FileRoller command domain does not have permission to execute anonymous memory or writable memory, it just didn't run because the program needs that functionality and FileRoader just doesn't have the permissions to do that. Similarly, FileRoader was not allowed to create a dir in config. And let's see what dir that was. Create here. Here it was actually Yelp running in the FileRoader domain, trying to create a Yelp dir in period config, but it wasn't allowed. So if you look at that, and that's all C home my login user config, it's not there if all is well. Because it wasn't allowed to create it. So what we need to do is basically we need to confine Yelp at some point. But for now we're going to just ignore that. And here is FileRoller denied access to execute Nautilus, because Nautilus actually has its own private type. So that was pretty... We could basically just take care of Yelp in a simple way by just actually giving it a private type. Let's just do that. Basically add that here, paste that in, and then make that Yelp exact T. And with that we're going to finish. This is the last thing I'm going to do. Yelp. Because you can basically keep going. But at some point you really have to basically say, okay, now that's it. We're done. And then just use something. For example, this one here. And then make that Yelp. 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 Step by step. But slowly but surely. Oops. Slowly but surely the GNOME shell becomes more functional. We can use a shell. We can use the disk users analyzer. We can use the file roller. We can use the system monitor. We can't use Nautilus yet. But that's one hell of a project. So now, if I try it again now, Yelp, I need to make sure that I restore Condo. But then, actually, so Yelp needs execman. That's nasty. But then we can basically make it fail gracefully. So now, for example, if I do this, and go to help contents, it fails gracefully without actually doing all that nasty stuff that it did before. So yeah, we're cool. It's nice. It's getting we're getting somewhere. So I'm gonna exit and log off, and I'll leave it at that for this episode. And of course, now you'll see that in its 3, every once in a while XDM messes up, in its 5. Now it's back. All right, so that's it.